housekeeping items here, as far as the minutes. Has everybody reviewed the minutes, or would you like more time to review the minutes of the past meetings? We do have two meetings to review the minutes with.
Okay.
One was the 18th, and one was the 24th of January.
Right, in terms of the ones that, yeah, I didn't have any corrections on mine, but.
No corrections?
I don't think, I read them through once, I didn't, nothing jumped out.
Okay, should we postpone? We can postpone.
Until next month.
Postpone meeting minutes. I guess the first thing I'd like to do is acknowledge the service of our previous chair, Andy Friedman. I am currently the chair as of the last meeting that we had. Andy, I think, has exemplified the spirit of participation in public affairs, and I'd like to thank Andy for your guidance, leadership, and dedication to the public health of our fine town.
Thank you.
And I'd like to open the public hearing.
Just the format, you can introduce themselves.
Yes. Welcome everyone to the Reading Board of Health public hearing. We appreciate your time to be here tonight. This public hearing is for the public to discuss proposed tobacco control regulations for the town of Reading. Copies of this proposal have been made available at Town Hall and at the Board of Health link on the town's website. If everyone has signed in already, on the back there was a, Darlene, do we have the sign-in sheet with the...
The agenda and the copy of the changes are available at the sign-in.
Yeah, at sign-in, the copy of the changes proposed are on the back of the hearing notice. Hey, John.
She wants to read her letter because she has a school committee meeting.
Sure. So,
to go to.
Okay.
And then here's the...
The Reading Board of Health is a three-member and currently one associate member that is appointed by the Board of Selectmen. The purpose of the board is to promote and protect the public health of the citizens of Reading. We derive our authority from the Massachusetts Legislature, and the members are currently me, John Costigan, the chair, Beth Sherland, Andy Friedman, and our associate member, Nancy Doctor. Because of the broad interest in tobacco control, every effort has been made to provide a public forum for the exchange of ideas and views. Over the past several months, the Board of Health meetings, we've discussed the regulations and have heard comments from the public. I'd like to thank those who came to share their views and gave valuable input to help create reasonable and just regulations while maintaining the primary interest and goals of public health. As the purpose of this public hearing is to collect information and opinions, the board will not entertain questions or ask for a vote from the audience tonight. The board may not vote on the proposal tonight after this public hearing. If not, we will announce the meeting date to which we will discuss and vote on the proposal. That meeting will be public. However, the board will not provide time for further public testimony unless a board member has a specific question to which an audience member can offer some clarification. After tonight's public hearing, the board will decide whether to accept further written testimony, and if so, will set a deadline for such communication. If the proposal is passed, the approved regulation will be posted at Town Hall and publicized in summary form in the Reading Chronicle and Advocate within 30 days of passage. In the interest of time, we ask that you adhere to the following ground rules. Any person wishing to make a comment should sign in, and the sign-in sheet is here and now here, if everyone has signed in already. The sign-in sheet will be used to call for public comment, and one may pass on commenting if so desired. When addressing the board, please identify yourself by name, address, and affiliation that you may have. And because of the number of people, please limit your comments to 3 minutes per person so that other members in the audience will have a chance to speak. And please be considerate of those speaking, whether you agree or disagree with them, and refrain from commenting out of turn. And thank you for your cooperation. Let's see. The proposed changes I'd like to read into the record. Newer revised definitions for characterizing flavor, flavored tobacco product, and tobacco product. Two, prohibit the sale of any flavored tobacco, including electronic cigarettes, except in retail tobacco stores where no one under the age of 21 is permitted entry. Require packages of two or more cigars to be priced at $5 or more, and a change in the stated changes. It was stated as maintaining the current requirement that single cigars be priced at $2.50 or more. Currently, there is no current minimum. Some of the, if you've seen some of them, you can get 50 cents a piece or 3 for 99 cents. So that is a mistake, and please put that into the record. Four, prohibit tobacco sales at any new store locations within 1,000 feet of a school zone. And five, to reduce the maximum number of tobacco product sales permits issued in town under either of the following two circumstances. One, the holder of a tobacco product sales permit does not renew his permit because he no longer sells tobacco products. Or two, the holder of a tobacco product sales permit does not renew his permit because he closes the retail business and does not sell it. In either of these two cases, the tobacco product sales permit would be returned to the Reading Board of Health and would be permanently retired, reducing the maximum number of tobacco sales permit in Reading by the number of permits retired. Please note that the current Reading Tobacco Control Regulations set the maximum number of tobacco product sales permits issued by the town at 19 and authorized the buyer of a current business holding a tobacco product sales permit to continue selling tobacco products, so long as that buyer applies for the product sales permit within 60 days of purchasing the business. The proposed change to the tobacco control regulations will not change the authorization for buyers. Since we're going to be going in order of who signed in, I'd like to, we did actually get written communication, so I'd like to do the written communication first. one of which was from Elaine Webb. Can we get you to speak first, just because I think you have other issues this evening? Certainly. I have one, thanks. Thank you.
Thank you. Elaine Webb, 309 Pearl Street, Precinct 1, and I'm also currently the Vice President of the Reading Coalition Against Substance Abuse. And I would like to just read a statement that most of the board members support this statement. There are a few members of our board that, because of staff positions and conflict of interest, they can't sign on to this. But the letter is signed by myself and our president, Mr. Patrick Shannon. And again, really the large majority of the board members support this letter. So I'd like to just, in direct response to fatal opioid overdoses in Reading, MCASA was formed in 2006 as a sustainable collaborative community approach to substance abuse prevention based on the strategic prevention framework. MCASA's mission is to address our substance abuse problem that youth in Reading, Massachusetts abuse alcohol, prescription drugs, nicotine, and other illegal drugs at unacceptably high rates that emerge early in adolescence, happen frequently, and indicate heavy use. To realize our mission, we promote healthy community environment using the strategic prevention framework to ensure that everyone who lives, works, or goes to school in Reading can enjoy an optimum quality of life. Tobacco abuse continues to be the leading cause of preventable death and disease in Massachusetts. In recognition of the devastating effects of tobacco use, local boards of health, with the support of state and national laws, have literally transformed how we access cigarette products. And I just want to add, our youth RACASA group, I think it was maybe 4 or 5 years ago now, was one of the leading groups in Massachusetts to begin to address removal of tobacco products in the pharmacies. And they took an amazing leadership role. So we've certainly shown leadership in Reading in this area in the past. However, the sea change resulting decrease in cigarette availability and smoking by teens has prompted Big Tobacco to cultivate a broad array of underpriced flavored and nicotine products that are geared to the youth market. Flavored tobacco, including an array of candy-flavored cigars and cigarillos, are heavily marketed to our youth with colorful product packaging. Young people are much more likely to use candy and fruit-flavored tobacco products than adults. High school students in Massachusetts, and this is from the 2015 Youth Risk Behavior Survey, reported twice the rate of cigar use compared to adults in the United States, and that was a 10% usage rate versus 5%. This directly corresponds to the expanded product line of cigars. In 2012, the flavored cigar market represented 20% of product availability at an average convenience store. Over the last 5 years, flavored cigars have increased to 15% of the cigar product line at stores. This information was gathered through Nielsen scanners, and if you are not convinced, you just need to take a walk through any of the convenience stores. The availability of these products in the marketplace is also an attempt to dodge the federal regulations that resulted from tobacco lawsuits, according to the Campaign for Tobacco-Free Kids. To evade the federal flavored cigarette ban, cigarette makers have manipulated their products to become little or filtered cigars. The Surgeon General's report, Preventing Tobacco Use Among Youth and Young Adults, noted that flavored cigarettes such as Sweet Dreams reemerged as Sweet Dreams flavored cigars after the federal restriction on flavored cigarettes went into effect. The restrictions and the ability to modify and control these to protect our youth is something that New York City implemented regulations in 2009. So this is not something that's new to us. And I believe the documentation on the backside, you've highlighted many other communities that have already implemented regulations similar to what you're proposing. In a research letter published in the Journal of American Medicine in 2015, a survey of 13,000 US students demonstrated the impact of flavored cigar availability on their first use. The survey indicated that the majority of youth ages 12 to 17 who self-reported either ever experimenting with a tobacco product started with flavored products, and that most current youth usage reports starting with flavored products. So the Reading Coalition and our director could not be here today to just partake and listen to the hearing. She's in Washington, but we really want to voice our strong support in favor of the regulations, and we thank the Board of Health for putting in all this excellent work. Thank you.
Thank you, Elaine. The next written communication I have is from Dan Duar, the proprietor of Reading Quick Stop. Is Dan, Dan's here?
I'm here, yes.
Would you like me to read this in, or would you like to read your communication?
It's not necessary to read it in, but I'll speak when my turn comes up.
Okay.
Thank you.
Next on the list, Sean Ferris from Woburn Street. Would you like to come up and address the board? Please, state your name, address, please.
Yes, my name is Sean Ferris. I'm at 183 Woburn Street, Reading, Mass. I understand what you guys are trying to accomplish here. I somewhat agree with you guys. I somewhat disagree. You keep taking a lot of things away from businesses in the town, and if you're just going to limit them from, taking the sick go to buy cigarettes or e-cigarettes is what their thing. Some of it's not all that of a bad thing, and I'll tell you firsthand. I used to smoke over a pack a day of cigarettes, and I went into the vapor cigarettes, just the flavored kind, and it helped me quit smoking. I thought I was really surprised about it, but I've heard a lot of people were talking about it, and I tried it. I looked at the pros and cons, and you know what? I'm grateful today to really be smoke-free, so that's a positive thing. For like far as convenience stores, you have these things in place where they have to be 21 years old to purchase these products. So you just don't want them in a convenience store, but it's up to the owners of these convenience stores. If they sell to minors, they get fined, they get penalized, and they can lose their license on it. And this has happened. You guys had some stings or little operations in the town, which is great. And some people lost their, they got fined, they lost so many days, and that's fine too. But I guess you would have to find a way to control it. You can't just completely eliminate and ban it. There always can be there's a will, there's a way. You're saying that the cigars are 50 cents and kids are just buying it because it's cheap enough for them. I'll tell you, I think most of the people who just buy them anyways, they're just buying it and they're putting their marijuana paraphernalia and pot in it, whatever they do. They're just going to bundle them up higher to sell $5 and sell 20 of them in there. They're just going to buy it. It's not a deal breaker. 50 cents or $2 is not going to break, the people from doing it, from buying it. You can eliminate, all these towns are still going to buy it. They can buy stuff, the vapor stuff. They buy it right on the internet. People come in and they say, I can buy it right online. It's just the same thing. So, I think I'm opposed to it. I don't mind you guys regulating it with certain things, like, when you put in the limits of cigars for $5, some people just don't have the $5, and they want a cigar opposed to a pack of cigarettes, and, you have to look at the average person doing it. These kids are, if the young people, you're not saying minors, but the young people, they have choices to make, and it's, if they don't get it here, they can get it somewhere else, and it's not a deal breaker. I think you want to be more friendly to these businesses in town. Some of these convenience stores, if you look at the profit margins across the board, they have to sell a lot of many things, and certain things they make money on, certain things they don't make money on. They're just going to, we really, kind of need these little convenience stores in town. That's, all I have to say. Take that.
Thank you for your comments. Thank you. Tim Brooks?
Yes.
From 37 Pearl Street. Thank you.
My comments are very much the same as Sean's. At 21, you know, people can make their own choices and decide what they want to smoke, what they don't want to smoke. When it comes to living at the house, and the parents should be telling the kids what they should be doing. There's a responsibility there. It's not up to Dan to do that. His job is to screen the number of people that come in that are under 21 to prevent that sale. It's a good thing, and I agree with that. But his job is to sell a product, which is all of the things in his store, and be successful. That pays your dues or whatever it is that you need to do here. You know, you have to have business here, and that's one of the businesses. And 20 years ago, I could have bought a pack of Campbell's down there, and that helped pay for it. You know, so, but that was my choice. I quit. That's my choice. It's not his job to screen everybody that comes in. His job is to keep people from buying cigarettes if they're under 21.
Thank you. Thank you. Carol Reedy?
I pass.
Okay. Ron Beauregard? Please state your name and address, please.
Sure thing. It's Ron Beauregard. My workplace is in Andover, at the Andover Town Hall. I run the tobacco control program for 18 communities, including a few of your neighboring boards of health here. So I figured I'd make a few comments to let you know how things have worked in our collaborative. We do represent Linfield in North Andover. We represent North Reading. North Andover was the first to start with the flavor restriction. They were among the first dozen or so in the state that went with the flavor restriction. What I have found is that the resistance to the flavor restriction has waned as it's become more popular. I now look at the towns that I have. After North Andover, we had Linfield, as I mentioned. Methuen came in next. North Andover's has been in effect for 2.5 years. Linfield, Methuen, Middleton, they've been in effect for 1.5 years. And then after that, Billerica, Tewksbury, and then finally North Reading, which just went into effect about 6 months ago. What I have found with all of those retailers, and they number, let's see, I have them up here, 184 retailers. So the person that's speaking to you right now has met with 184 retailers throughout these communities. And what I've learned is sort of a lesson that it's a lesson in adaptation, much like the adaptation that I witnessed when I worked with the tobacco control program in the early 2000s, where the smoking bans in restaurants and bars. And there was a lot of concern among the retail community in regard to how it would impact them economically. And I've heard that this evening as well. I think the tough thing that the boards of health have, and I've witnessed this with all the boards of health I work with, is that the retailers kind of sit in that classic battle between those who want to perpetuate tobacco use, the tobacco companies, and public health officials like yourself who want to curb it. The most important thing I've learned through these few years of dealing with the flavor restriction, as well as all those communities I mentioned, by the way, due to the minimum cigar pricing, is that after that initial resistance, and it is a concern, and no one can look any of the retailers in the eye and say they won't make any impact on their business. It can. It's the delicate balance that you have to make to decide what advances public health but does not kill a business. All right? And none of the businesses have gone out of business. That doesn't mean they haven't been impacted. But they haven't gone out of business. They've moved forward. Some of the communities that have the minimum pricing law, they do sell single cigars for that minimum $2.50, even though they were previously 79 cents and a dollar. Some do not. And I think what's happened is a lot of the retailers on the cigar packaging have begun to sell packages of about 4 cigars for $5, which is a unit price of $1.25. all the peer review research, and I'm sure you probably heard a little bit earlier, the main thing on the flavor restriction, the peer review, and I'm sure you're going to provide the testimony that I can provide written testimony if it's not provided, is that why do we flavor things? I'm 55, so in the 70s and the 60s, if I wanted a mango ice cream, then people would look at me like I had three heads. Now if you want a mango smoothie, a mango yogurt, a mango scented candle, a mango air freshener, you're going to find it. And unfortunately, you're also going to find a mango infused cigarillo or flavors in vaping. These aren't banned. They're restricted into smoke shops. They're called retail tobacco stores in the proposed regulations, where if you're 21 and you want to smoke a mango cigarillo, you can do it to your heart's content. You can do the strawberry, the grape, the watermelon, tropical paradise, whatever you call it. It's not a ban. I'll leave you with this. I urge you to follow that peer review research. Some of it actually goes digging into the tobacco company's purpose of putting flavors. They recognize the flavor explosion. They understand there's an excitement about it. They also understand that it reduces the harshness of the tobacco. It gives it an easier aftertaste. It makes it more enjoyable, and there's even a comment made, curiosity to try factor. And these are things, in fact, when I meet with the retailers, we don't see eye to eye on everything, but we have a conversation, and I always tell them, we both want to curb youth access to tobacco. I want to do it in a way that makes a statement that if you're going to a store where kids frequent, that there's not going to be any blurred lines between the mango juice or orange juice or what have you with the tobacco products. Thank you for your time. I apologize if I went over the time.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Yeah.
Erin Calvo Bacci.
Thank you. Erin Calvo Bacci, 494 Main Street. And I am here as a parent speaking. So in regards to the limit flavored other tobacco products, including e-cigarettes, to adult-only retail tobacco stores, my concern is it's bad policy because there are laws to prohibit minors, those under 21, from purchasing these products. But there are no laws to go after these children or these minors in possession of these products. Currently at the middle school, there are, unfortunately, some children who are under in-school suspension for having vaporizers. You can order those products online. So if we really are intending to protect our children, then we need to focus on the laws that do in fact protect the children and do not hurt the adults who are choosing to partake in these products. I am not a fan of tobacco products. We do not smoke in my family. We try to live a more healthy lifestyle, but adults are free to make their own decisions. And this is just bad policy that is not prohibiting minors from getting these products. And it is, in fact, hurting the very people who are following the laws, such as Dan, who, if he were to sell to a minor, then there would be legal ramifications for that. He's simply a business owner who's trying to support himself and his family, and we should encourage that, especially in this town, when we see so many financial hardships, and we need to encourage more businesses and to take this away from him without really going after the laws to protect children is really just bad policy. Thank you.
Thank you. John Hildreth.
John Hildreth. Precinct 7, 2 Waverly Road, born and raised from this town my whole life, 5 years. I support what Danny's trying to do to keep in trying to do the right thing. I agree with that young lady just said. I think you try to regulate too much because you can buy anything you want on the internet. And another point of view is if you go to other towns around, you can buy them any way you want. I'm basically here in support of Danny. Thank you.
Thank you very much. John Hildreth. I'm sorry, Paul. Paul Cummings.
Good evening, Paul Cummings, 21 Chiquessa Road. I'm here in support of Dan. I am a retired business owner. I understand margins. I understand why he sells many products in his store. And to my knowledge, as long as I've known Dan, I have never seen him sell any of these tobacco products to anyone under the age of 21. And your own licensee, giving him a license, says that he can sell people who are 21, and at 21, they're adults, and they can make their own decisions. I also wanted to say the first speaker, I would like to applaud for her work in the opiate council that she worked on. I think that is one of the most important things that the town should be working on, the state and the federal government, is opiate abuse. Can you bear with me a minute? I won't go over my 3 minutes. The cigars, I'm against government rate setting, setting the price of a product. I don't think that's right. I don't think that's something the government should be doing. The flavored products you're talking about banning. Again, the age is 21. If you can't buy them unless you're 21 years old. So, Reading at one time had a 18 for cigarettes, I believe, in the last 6, 7, 8 years, time goes by. And I believe that was raised to 21. Correct me if I'm wrong. And with cigarettes being at 21, it makes perfectly sense to me that these flavored e-cigarettes would go along with that. And that's what you just did. You raised it to 21, to an adult. But at 21, they're adults. I have children. I have young adults now. They are over 21. Thank you for that woman that's helping with the opiate abuse. And I think that businesses like Dan and all the other convenience stores and all the other stores, if they follow the rules and they sell things at 21, I believe they have the right to. As a former businessman, that's my opinion. Right. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Paul. Kathy Whitaker.
Right here. Kathy Whitaker, 6 Puritan Road.
I am also the public health nurse at the Winchester Board of Health. And about 1.5 years ago, we went through the same thing. And we did pass regulations very, very similar to this. And I think that as surrounding communities, that we have to be unified. And so that the buying of these products, if they can't get them in Winchester, they come to Reading. If they can't get them in Winchester, they go to another town that did not pass these. Very, very important. Nicotine is so addictive. They say just smoking 3 cigarettes that a person can become addicted. And with all these flavors, it's much more enticing. So I'm fully in support of passing these regs.
Thank you very much. Sure, I was just going to ask, that's the end of my list of sign-ins. I was going to ask if anyone else that didn't have a chance to sign in, would you?
No, this won't. Is there
another side, maybe? Oh, I'm sorry. There we are. Next, Peggy Russo.
Oops. Hi, I'm from Chopsford. I'm not from town, but I'm here because I am in favor of all these regulations. I am a certified tobacco treatment specialist. I see in the last few years, and I currently just volunteer my time as a tobacco treatment specialist, but we see more and more kids, young adolescents, that would never entertain the thought of smoking a traditional cigarette, but they are, you know, enticed by these flavored products. They are trying them, they're becoming addicted to nicotine, and then they end up smoking regular cigarettes. So we can keep these in adult-only retail tobacco stores. It just makes it that much harder for these kids to get them. They can't go into any variety store or, you know, any department store where they still sell these products. So I'm in favor of all of these regulations. We need to get them out of the, you know, the kids' hands. Flavored tobacco, electronic cigarette, all these things, they're geared towards these kids. I'm a former smoker, and when I was a kid and I started at the ripe old young age of 12, you know, I would have loved to have something that tasted like candy. I would have loved to have all these fruit-flavored things, you know? And perhaps it wouldn't have taken me so long to be an expert in smoking. So it's really important to get these back into adult stores. Thank you very much.
Kathleen O'Leary?
Hi, I'm Kathleen O'Leary. I live at 81 Middlesex Avenue. I am a nurse practitioner. I specialize in pain management and tobacco treatment, and I'm a certified tobacco treatment specialist. My career path has taken me down tobacco treatment. I work at a 320-bed hospital as a tobacco treatment nurse practitioner. Every day, I get a list of patients who have answered yes to tobacco use within the past 30 days. I see roughly 20 patients a day. There's 30 to 40 patients on my list daily. I primarily try to help them with symptoms of withdrawal coming into a smoke-free environment. And we also help counsel these patients because we know every time we attempt to counsel a patient, it gets them closer to a quit attempt. My patients are over the age of 18. I ask every patient, when did you start using a tobacco product, a nicotine product? The majority of my patients state in their teenage years. And we know that 90% of tobacco users started before the age of 18. The teenage developing brain becomes highly addicted to nicotine. We are born with nicotine receptors. We stimulate them when we take in nicotine into our system. When a patient is trying to quit, We use nicotine replacement therapy to help them wean down. It's an arduous process. It takes not only medication, but also counseling. The average American smoker, it takes 10 quit attempts to quit, 2 for some and 20 for others. I also volunteer my time here in Reading for tobacco users and nicotine users. I have an 11-year-old in the school system. He's exposed to these things. I fully support our CASA because it educates our community and our families about the changing times and products that are out there. And I fully support these regulations to keep one less avenue out of the hands of the children.
Thank you. Louis Adriani.
Louis Adriani, 14 School Street, Reading. I agree with what everybody said here. I watch a lot of town meetings. I watch a lot of local cable TV around here. And I agree that there's two issues here. And I appreciate the gentleman from Andover is talking about the economics of it and everybody else's concern, Kathy, from the health aspect. And I agree with that. The thing is, Dan was issued a license to procure a convenience store and sell products. And part of that was some tobacco products. And I'm not an advocate of tobacco products. Not an advocate. In fact, if I had my way, we wouldn't have fast food, we wouldn't have fried food, we wouldn't have coffee shops where you'd get a double mocha latte with half cow cream, cinnamon, and all that other stuff. But people get to the point where they can make their own decisions. So I see people going into Dunkin' Donuts and getting 15 of the sucrose in their coffees, and I'm like, what are you doing, right? But the point is, it's their decision. We're talking. I've heard you talking to Mr. Halsey on some of the local cable TVs about being economically viable. I fear that Dan is going to suffer by 1,000 cuts, literally what the gentleman from Andover was saying. You're crippling his business. He runs a safe business. He's very conscientious. I respect him, which is why I'm here. He didn't know I was coming tonight. He didn't know I was speaking tonight. I'm speaking because I respect this process, and I just want him to be able to continue his viable business while protecting the health of the local citizens here and the youth. I'm not crazy about smoking at all. Not, like I said, all the other health aspects. We don't regulate sugar to kids. The other thing is, some of these people, I think Sean mentioned this, use the flavored e-cigarettes to cut down on his smoking. I equate that to someone who goes to a fast food restaurant and supplements or replaces Coke and Pepsi with Diet Coke, Diet Pepsi, Tab. Everybody's familiar with this stuff, right? So from my perspective, at least, using an e-cigarette is not healthy, but it's a much better replacement for a cigarette. So there's no tar, and it just produces water vapor. It's no yellow fingers, no yellow walls, no yellow teeth. So it's a better option of worst set of options, similar to all the Diet Cokes and the artificial sweeteners that people are using, thinking that they're making it better for themselves. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't, but it is their choice. That's all I wanted to say, but for the most part, I agree with what everybody said here.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sarah McColgan.
To pass out something to the... Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Sarah McColgan. I'm not a Reading resident, but I'm the director of the Massachusetts Health Officers Association Tobacco Control Program. And Massachusetts Health Officers Association is the trade association for your Board of Health staff. I'm one of three people in the state that works with local boards of health on policy development in tobacco control. So I'd like to talk to you a little bit about the four main provisions that you're looking at in this revision of your regulations, those being the cigar packaging and minimum pricing provision, limiting the number of tobacco sales permits, limiting flavor to other tobacco products, and no new retailers within 1,000 feet of schools. The cigar provision came about as a result of some studies that were done in Boston, and it was enacted in Boston in 2001. Studies subsequent to that have shown that it's been very effective. And when we talk about the effectiveness of it, youth buy and smoke single cheap flavored cigars more than cigarettes. Cigarette consumption among youth has gone way down, and cigar consumption has increased. Between 2000 and 2013, cigar consumption increased by 114%, while cigarette consumption decreased by 37%. So kids are buying something that's cheap, sweet, and easy to get. They actually have, you know, change back from their lunch money when they buy a cigar. So that's one reason why we looked at that policy and set the price at $2.50. Now, when you take a 50 cent or an 89 cent cigar and you raise the price to $2.50, the retailer keeps the difference. It's not going into the state general fund or anything. It's profit to the retailer. The public health goal in doing all of this is to discourage youth from impulse purchases like cheap cigars, which will lead to nicotine addiction. And as I said, it's been shown to be very effective in Boston. It doesn't affect the premium cigars, which is what a lot of adults buy. It just affects, those are generally over $250 to begin with. It just affects the cheap things that the kids are buying. To date, there hasn't been any data provided by retailers or their trade associations that show that the cigar packaging has caused any economic harm to vendors. I've given you a list of municipalities that have enacted all of these provisions, and if you reference the cigar packaging one, there are over 138 municipalities that have already enacted this provision in some form or another. Limiting the number of tobacco sales permits has also been enacted by 87 cities and towns across the state, and I understand you're looking at capping your permits to 19. It provides conditions for renewal, the sale of permit holders, businesses, and a wait list if the maximum numbers reach. So if there are 19, anybody wanting to open a store can open a store, they just can't have a tobacco permit, but they would be put on the wait list if a permit was turned in. It reduces retailer density, which is always much higher for tobacco than liquor permits in any given community. And the public goal, health goal, is to reduce the density and exposure of tobacco products to minors. When kids go into stores, they're bombarded with advertising from the tobacco industry in terms of the packaging, signs in the windows, everything. And so a mother carrying in a toddler to go in and get a gallon of milk in a convenience store, that toddler is being bombarded with these messages. They may not understand it if they're 2 or 3 years old, but you know, years ago, they did a study among six-year-olds and showed them a picture of Camel Joe and a picture of Mickey Mouse. And in those old Camel Joe days, they recognized Camel Joe more than they recognized Mickey Mouse. So these kids are being bombarded with these messages from a very young age. I'm not going to talk to you about banning the sale of flavored tobacco products, because we're not talking about banning the sale of flavored tobacco products. We're talking about limiting and restricting where they can be sold. And the provision talks about restricting them to adult-only retail tobacco stores. Now, I'm not familiar with the tobacco vendors in Reading. I don't know if you have any adult-only retail tobacco stores. But that's not to say that one or two couldn't open here in town. I firmly believe that it's time that we take the tobacco industry at their word. For generations, they've been telling us this isn't a product that they've made or that they market to kids. We've all heard them say it. If you remember, they testified before Congress, and they said this isn't something for kids. And so I think we should take them at their word. If it's not a product for kids, remove it from the environment that kids are in. Put it in an adult-only tobacco store where kids are not allowed to even enter the building. Again, the flavor restriction is not a ban, it's a restriction. It restricts the products to the adult-only tobacco store. And I think it's time that we take the industry at their word. Youth who shop in convenience stores that sell tobacco products two or more times a week are 64% more likely than their peers who don't go into those stores to start smoking. So they're being bombarded with the message, and the result is they're more likely to start smoking. 84 communities in Massachusetts have already passed this ban. It was started in Providence, Rhode Island, which is in the same federal court circuit district as Massachusetts is, and that cleared the way for the policy to be used in Massachusetts. And interestingly enough, Providence is now coming to Massachusetts and asking for help and guidance in how to enforce the restriction which they started, because we have been doing it more effectively than the folks that we modeled it after. The last one being no tobacco sales permits issued to new retailers within 1,000 feet of a school. Your list shows 66 cities and towns that have enacted the policy within 500 feet, but I understand that you folks want to keep this policy similar to, I guess, marijuana. So you've gone with 1,000 feet. It provides conditions for permit renewal and the sale of permit holders' business. And the public health goal, again, is to reduce tobacco sales and exposure to minors near school. So it's not just kids buying cigarettes, it's kids being exposed to the marketing, to the message from the tobacco industry that's always been insidious for generations. And I hope that you consider these four provisions and that you would vote in these regulations. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. Maureen Busby.
This is I only have one of these letters because I think I got it last minute, but I don't know if it was at least. Hi, Maureen Busby, 54 West Highland Avenue, Melrose, Massachusetts. I'm also the Regional Tobacco Program Coordinator. First of all, thank you for allowing me to speak tonight. The strategies that are being considered this evening are all strategies endorsed by the Massachusetts Department of Public Health Tobacco Cessation and Prevention Program. Since these are all evidence-based strategies that are effective in reducing youth use of tobacco and nicotine products. This particular comment isn't in my notes because it was kind of a late-breaking thing. Cheryl Sabara, who is with the Mass Association of Health Boards, submitted a letter to the chair, but I'm not sure she had the right email address because there's a new chair. So I did provide a hard copy of that which is there on the table. I didn't make copies for everybody because I thought that transmission had been submitted electronically, and it wasn't. I just wanted to make sure that you got a copy of her comments. I also did submit a 2016 Washington Post article which reports on skyrocketing e-cigarette use among teens. This is after decades of decreasing teen smoking rates. Now if we look at the combined smoking rates of, or use rates rather, of smoking of conventional tobacco products and e-cigarette use, which is not a tobacco product but is a nicotine product, then we find a huge jump, which is concerning to us. So we're trying to do all that we can to put up roadblocks for kids getting these products. I've also submitted the results of a 2015 survey of 447 Wakefield High School students. There were 8 questions on the survey, all related to e-cigarette and flavored cigar use. I'll highlight the results of just 3 of the questions. One question asked the students, what is the main reason you tried an e-cigarette or a flavored cigar? 44.4% said they were attracted to the flavor. Another question asked, how did you get your e-cigarette or flavored cigar? 64.3% reported that they got them from a friend. The last question on the survey asked, if these products weren't available in flavors, would you use them? 65.5% answered no. We don't have comparable data for Reading High School students because these questions aren't on your YRBS survey. This was actually a special survey taken in Wakefield to try to get our hands around some data for youth use of these newer products. But since Reading's demographics are similar to Wakefield's, I suspect the results of such a survey in Reading would be similar. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Diane Knight.
Diane Knight, and I direct the Northeast Tobacco Free Community Partnership, which does serve the community of Reading, and it's a program funded by the Department of Public Health. My office is at the Greater Lawrence Family Health Center at 1 Griffin Brook Drive in Methuen. And I work a little differently than Maureen and Ron. We all work for the Massachusetts Tobacco Cessation and Prevention Program, but my work is mostly community-based and doing education and mobilization in the community, and in this case around policy and in other tobacco-related areas. I want to thank you for proposing the revisions that strengthen your existing tobacco regulations, and I support raising the price of the single cigars and the multi-packs to $5. Massachusetts statistics indicate that youth smoke single, cheap, flavored cigars more than cigarettes, and a single cigar can cost as little as 50 cents. The tobacco industry prices these products cheaply to encourage impulse buys by adolescents and uses fruit and candy-flavored tobacco products to attract and target our young people. These products, as you know, are readily available all kinds of places that youth frequently visit, and you heard data about what happens when youth actually see these faces of the tobacco products and they frequent the establishments where they are. And these flavored tobacco products are considered starter products by the U.S. Food and Drug Administration and the U.S. Surgeon General that aid in the establishment of smoking patterns that can lead to long-term addiction. The tobacco industry is targeting our kids with these products, as we've heard repeatedly by so many people that have come up and been testifying. We must protect our youth, since adolescents are especially harmed because of the way nicotine changes the adolescent brain, and we heard that from the nurses that were here testifying tonight. People who start smoking as adolescents, they smoke more, they have a harder time quitting than people who start as adults. A recent report of the Surgeon General finds that more than 85% of e-cigarette users ages 12 to 17 use flavored e-cigarettes, and flavors are the leading reason for youth use. I support limiting flavored tobacco products. Obviously, I'm handing to each of you the new data from the Department of Public Health on the use of electronic nicotine delivery products among high school youth in Massachusetts. The data is from 2015 Youth Risk Behavior Survey. These electronic products have increased dramatically with their wide availability and attractive flavors and pervasive marketing. Ever used is high school youth who have ever used is 44.8%. That's one in two high school students versus 13.9% of adults. Current users in high school, 23.7% versus 2.7% of adults. High school youth currently use electronic these electronic products at a higher rate than all other tobacco products. And all other tobacco products would be 15.9% versus the current use of electronic products at 23.7%. So tobacco companies use flavorings in these smokeless tobacco products as part of a graduation strategy to encourage new users to start with flavored products with lower levels of nicotine and work their way up to more addictive products. The Surgeon General reminds us that the use of products containing nicotine in any form among youth, including e-cigarettes, is unsafe. And I really, that is so important, that nicotine is unsafe for teens. And we have heard all kinds of things about the brain. 16 other communities in the Northeast where I work have taken steps to remove the flavored products from stores, and Ron spoke to those communities, and I work with him in a lot of those communities as well. And I support Reading in joining this movement. And thank you for your commitment to the health and well-being of Reading youth and families.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Jacqueline Callahan.
Hi, my name is Jacqueline Callahan. I live out of town as well, but I work for the Reading Memorial High School, so I'm here on behalf of the students at our school, and also I am the advisor for the youth club after school that we have that works with ARCASA. They're youth promoting healthy lifestyles, and they promote drug-free and healthy lifestyles. As an educator for the town of Reading, I'm concerned with how easy it is for youth to access nicotine and tobacco products, not just in Reading, overall anywhere. The flavored tobacco and nicotine products are more appealing to youth, and having these products easily available in town stores is going to make it more likely that our youth will try these products. According to the Center for Disease Control, 7 out of 10 youth who do use tobacco products currently use flavored products. The regulations, I support the regulations to limit the sale of flavored tobacco and nicotine products because we know that these products are designed to entice children and teens. Promoting these products just isn't the right thing to do. I understand the concerns that small business owners may have regarding these regulations, but again, they're regulations. We're not saying that you can't sell these products at all. And these regulations will hopefully help to decrease the access of products to youth and teens. We do need to consider that having these products in the stores not only increases the access, but also the exposure to our youth. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Annabelle Taylor.
As a teen, I am concerned for the well-being of my peers. The advertising of the flavored tobacco and nicotine to youth needs to be changed. According to the study published by the Centers of Disease and Control and Prevention and the Food and Drug Administration, an estimated 70% of U.S. middle and high school students have used a tobacco product in the past 30 days. So I fully support the board in passing the proposed regulations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Casey Bowers.
My apologies, it's to the previous chair.
Hi, Casey Bowers. I live at 27 Dana Road over by the school. And my day job to pay the bills, I'm actually the public policy director for the American Lung Association. So as you might imagine, we are very much in support of these regulations. I won't belay this. Pretty much heard all the reasons why we would support this. We think it's a great way to protect kids. I did just want to mention one thing around the internet sales. Under the AG's regs that she signed last year, all of these electronic e-cigarettes that are sold online must go through age verification. So if that's something that's not being done or you're hearing that, then we should send those concerns to the AG because she can regulate it. So other than that, I think you've heard all the reasons why we would support it. So I urge you to consider this and support it, and thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Kyle Krupa.
Abstain.
Frank Rhodes.
Oh, he's there.
Good, thank you.
Please
just state your name and address.
Yep. Mike Rhodes, Green Street, born and raised. I'm here because I've heard about the regulation when it comes down to the flavor of e-cigarettes. I know several people that have actually stopped smoking and are in better health because of them, and they would have never tried it if it didn't have the flavors. And as far as them saying that the younger generation and kids and 20-year-olds are all using these flavored e-cigarettes, if I had it 20 years ago, I would have used it. And I'd probably still be using it now. Just like nowadays, we have flavored vodka, flavored coffee, and that's all granted right to the public. Now, as Ron said, a lot of these places have come in, and they have done the regulations, done all that stuff, but in every one of the towns he said, they have an actual vapor stores and tobacco stores. From my understanding, we don't have that in Reading. We do, I've never seen it. Do we have a vapor store or any type of tobacco store in Reading?
No.
Not at all. Okay, so.
There's no prohibition of.
And we're not sending new licenses out, so there won't be a new store for tobacco or vapor stores in Reading because of the new regulations that we have saying we're not going to give another permit, correct?
No, there's a limit on the permits.
And the limit on the permits is at its maximum.
No.
I thought you had said that in the beginning.
No.
Right, well, we don't have a vapor store in Reading or any of the stuff. I know his store sells vaporizer and all the flavored stuff. And I also know that everybody sells them stupid flavored cigar things, which I don't approve of because all it is marijuana cigarettes for kids. She said that. One of the ladies said that the rate for selling the flavored cigars went skyrocketed up to 114%, and cigarettes went down 37%. Cigarettes went down 37% because 37% didn't start smoking. The flavored cigars, I had never met a kid that smokes flavored cigars for a cigar. And I deal with a lot of youth, and I have a lot of troubled youth in my, because of what I volunteer doing. And so for them to say they're smoking flavored cigars is not too much reality. As far as anything else, as long as things are being regulated and things are being done properly and things aren't going over the edge, I see no reason why it shouldn't be done in our local stores. I know we have a lot of other places in town here that sell the cigars. Like I said, I don't personally approve of them because I know what they use them for. Do we have any other places in town that sell any type of e-cigarette product? That's a direct question.
No, I'm not sure. I don't have the information to answer that.
Anybody know of any other place in town that sells e-cigarette, like the flavored oils or whatever they're called?
Don't
Is there any other place in town?
I don't have that information.
Well, that would mean it's like a direct target. That's not really good. Because if there's not another place that sells them, then you're only targeting one particular store in town. I'll leave it at that. You guys have yourselves a beautiful day, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, and thank you.
Gene Delius.
All set.
Is it Kim McDonald?
Kevin McDonald.
I'm sorry, Kevin?
Yep. Kevin McDonald, 24 John Street. What I have in mind here is, as the gentleman just said, it seems to be directed at one person. I know the gentleman, I frequent his store all the time, and I think it is pointed directly at him. And if there is, it's very hard to get over these rules and regulations. But when it comes to him, I suggest that he set up some kind of grandfather rights so that he isn't directly the brunt of all this, so that he can get by with his business. That would be good. The spot is smoking, the kids smoking, you're not going to stop it. Too many adults doing it. The kids do what the adults do. But to narrow him out and stuff, to say he's already invested a fortune in this, and you authorized it once, and now you turn around and say, okay, you can't do it that way anymore, we're going to rehash it. You're only targeting him and costing him more money in the public. You get tax money from each of this tobacco. You should consider that it's an interest of the community. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. For Dan, Dan Dewar.
My name is Dan Dewar. I live at 519 Main Street. I also own Ready Quick Stop at 519 Main Street. I know you're not targeted me directly. I know it's for all the stores. However, one of the problems I have is when we did this in 2014, we went from 18 to 21, you know, I didn't support that. I understood where you're going, and I understand where you're going now. I had, about 20 people that came to that meeting, and most of them spoke, and two people got up and spoke against it, and it went through, everybody voted yes to do it. And so those same people I asked to come tonight, they said no because the fix is in. And I hope that's not the case, because I think that I do a good job. It's not, in my situation, it's not broken. I do not sell to anybody under 21, kids, anything like that. So they're not getting it from me. And they are getting it on the internet. And there's a button that says you're 21. There's nobody on the internet saying, no, you're not, or carding you. So yes, that's where they're getting it, a lot of it. They're not getting it from me, I assure you that. It's not broken in my case. It's nothing to fix here. As far as setting a price for a flavored cigar, I do have some adults over 21 that come in and buy them. I don't really sell a lot of them, so I mean, that would be negligible on mine. But the e-juice, I did put a big investment into that. When it went from 18 to 21, I'm looking for another revenue stream to support my business. I probably went down at least 5 cartons of cigarettes a week because of that. And again, I understand and I deal with it. But I think in this case, it's an overreach. It's overregulating. The problem isn't in my store. I'm a general store. I sell a lot of different stuff. I'm always looking for new revenue streams. And if I lose this, what's my next revenue stream? It goes from me working 70 to 75 hours a week to make up for that loss. I'll be looking for other revenue streams, and hopefully you won't take them away. I mean, what's next? The energy drinks, the candy, kids buy candy. Where does it stop? I do my part, and I do treat you guys like a partner. When Maureen comes into my store, we're very cordial, we exchange ideas. Other than that, I really don't talk to you people too much. I don't see you out in the community, in my store. you know, talking about some of these issues so we can partner. I do want to do my part. I don't condone smoking for children. I raised two daughters. One smokes, one doesn't. I wish the other one that smokes didn't. But I'm just a businessman trying to make a living, and I am not doing anything that warrants these regulations. In talking about the cigar provision, that's in 2001. Since then, it went from 18 to 21, and I think that, you know, most of the people are over 21 that are buying these. I know it gets into the kids' hands, and I do get that. I just tell you to get them from somewhere else from me. I am not the problem. What else did I want to say? You know, as far as the signs in my store, I have it's a Newport thing, and it says what the price is. I'm not advertising. You know, if a kid comes in with his mother, that there's an opportunity for dialogue to teach your kids and tell them how you want them to be. It's not brainwashing them. As far as flavors go, I mean, do we all turn black and white when we turn 18? We all like flavors. I don't think that they. I think that the tobacco companies and all the companies that do this stuff have been regulated to the point where they do not advertise to youngsters. I mean, they're advertising to adults that like flavors. You go into the liquor store, they have raspberry vodka, bubblegum vodka, all that stuff. They're not geared to kids. Neither is this. I think it's wrong to say that it is. I understand that it didn't in decades past, but I think that's been kind of buttoned up a little bit. As far as the weight, she talked about a wait list. It seems to me, I do need a clarification on that, because you wanted to limit the number of licenses, and once somebody gives up their license, it's retired. So it seems to me you'd always be capped out. How can somebody...
capped out now. There are 18.
We're at 18, so there's one more.
Yep.
But if I was to give mine up, we'd go to 17, correct?
No.
You'd go back to 18.
So you're going to maximize it. It'll stay at 19. It won't decrease.
Right.
It'll decrease with each one that's turned in. So you go from 19 that you have total to issue. For each person that owns a tobacco store now that turns in a license, it goes one less. All it's costing. It'll never go
more than correct. If they sell that establishment and it's continuing to sell tobacco, that license will within 60 days, it will maintain that.
All right. But if it doesn't, it retires, right?
Right.
But you can still get to 19.
It wouldn't retire, but there is a limit, and there is an opening right now. If two people were to apply for the permit, there would be a waiting list for the second one until the first one was approved or not.
Right. Okay, I understand. Can you read my own writing? I guess that's probably it. And also, I do want to talk about the e-liquid. Typically, e-liquids comes in many different flavors. I have a lot of professionals that come in and come in and get e-juice from me. If you take away my ability to sell flavors, that revenue goes to other towns. Wayfield has a couple of vape shops. Woolman's still at 18. And I talked to Stone, and it's not even on their radar right now to do these things. It probably will be soon, but not right now, it's not. So by doing that, all the people that would start, they're passing through Reading on 28, they're going to go elsewhere. They're going to go out of town. They're going to come in my store. You know, somebody comes in and buys an e-juice, they might buy a lottery ticket or a pack of gum or something like that. These are all different revenue streams. That's what keeps me in business. So I urge you not to pass that part of it. It's not broken. Don't fix it. I want to continue partnering with you. I'd like to do that in a better way than we have been, because the only time we really do interact is when I come to one of these meetings. And I do see Maureen, as I said, every once in a while, but that's just about it. She comes in to see what's going on, what I got for what kind of product and whatnot, and you know, make sure that, you know, I'm on the up and up. So, but other than that, I've never heard some, hey, what can you do to help us, you know, with this problem with the kids? It's just, I just think it's an overreach and overregulation. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. I believe that concludes the list of sign-ins that I have. If there's anybody that has not spoken, that is here, that hasn't signed in.
May I speak again?
Well, we're not, you've already had your say.
I do have 3 minutes, can I have one? 30 seconds?
Sure.
No, no, I'm sorry, no, we've, one say per person.
Stat Shannon, 516 Haverhill Street in Reading. I'm also involved with Arcasa. And I really don't have anything new to add to what I'm saying, other than to say that, you know, this obviously is a public health issue. And you know, this is a, you know, very, you know, tobacco is an addictive, dangerous substance. And you know, my feeling is that, you know, when I was in high school, 30-something years ago, there were a lot of kids smoking. And, you know, and things have changed, it's gone down. But the numbers that I'm seeing that, you know, we get reported to us kind of showing an increase, you know, with these flavored tobacco products. And, you know, we can't allow that to happen. You know, I think, you know, we need to, we focus on the youth. You know, we need to, you know, for everybody, we need to make it, you know, we tax the product to make it harder, to make it for everybody. But the youth in particular, it's, you know, we need to do what we can, you know, and we're not on the leading edge of this, right? We, you know, there are other towns that we're kind of now following in, you know, we're following a trend. So we're not on the leading edge. This isn't anything that, you know, maybe the 1,000-foot is a little different than what other towns are doing, but, you know, the limitations on the flavors, on the vape stuff, you know, we're actually more, you know, maybe on the beginning end of a trend, but this is the way things go. You know, I know the statement that Erica McDonough and Elaine Webb put in show statistics, you know, from New York City, and then local, like Wakefield, and I believe Winchester has these limitations too. So I agree that as surrounding communities, we need to have consistency in these rules too. So, you know, I firmly support these, and you know, I guess that's what I want to say.
Thank you. Is there any more comment or?
Yeah.
John Halsey.
I'm John Halsey. I live at Beaver Road. And I just really have two questions. One of them is, we heard some statistics about other communities where youth usage was up or down based on what the product was. So my first question is, do we have any statistics that, and I'm part of Arcasa as well, I happen to be on that board. And so I clearly, you know, am in favor of no kids with these products. I mean, what everybody has said from the standpoint of health, how could you question that? But I guess I'm just wondering, as you get ready in your decision-making process to understand, do we have any survey information, statistical information in Reading? We have many. We have a lot of data that's been collected tied to a variety of substances through Arcasa. Is one of those tobacco and the items in question is my first question. And the second one is, where are we on the continuum of violations? Do you have some statistics on establishments in town, what their violation rate is? So I know that as a member of the Board of Selectmen, we have such information when it comes to alcohol licenses, because we regulate those. That happens to be something that we're responsible for. And I'm sure that there's probably a similar thing that, because I think that's under your purview, I wonder if you have any kind of information about what the violation, so for example, the gentleman who runs a business here. I don't question for a second that he is vigilant about the 21 thing. You know, that law changed here in town, that regulation changed in town about 3 years ago, I think, is that right? 2014, somewhere around there. So has his store had violations? Have they been repeated? What about, what are the statistics? I guess what I'm asking is, what is our experience in Reading with violations, and is it a rampant problem? And if it is, then we certainly need to tighten that down. There are regulations. Are we, in fact, enforcing those the way that we ought to? I think we are, but I don't know. So my comments are not comments. They're more questions that I pose to you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Hi, Tony Caparo, 129 Ash Street, Reading. I've heard a lot of great points here tonight. I am here to support Dan. There's a ton of good points for both sides, but the thing is that it strikes me as this, is that it isn't easy. They're not gonna, there's no kids under, nobody under 21 are gonna get any products from Dan's store. He runs a tight ship. I mean, it's just something that takes away more from his business. I heard that they say that the kids can get these things online, but the main point is this, is they're not getting them at the Reading Click Stop. That I do know. He runs a tight ship, and I hate to see him lose the revenue. I mean, I'm against smoking too. I was a smoker for many years. I quit long ago, and I figure that they're gonna get them anyway, but they're not gonna get them at the Reading Click Stop. Thank you very much.
Thank you. No, I can't accept testimony. If I did, I'd have to for everyone, so I can't accept testimony. Right. Sorry.
I agree with this gentleman.
Is there anyone else that would like to speak and have not signed in? Hearing. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? No. The public hearing is closed. Thank you, everyone, for attending. The Board of Health meeting is still open, although the public hearing is closed. We still may be discussing. You're welcome to stay to hear our deliberations.
And we can ask them questions.
I would rather not. I would.
Okay.
Joe, how are you doing?
Yeah. I had a stroke, and I've been dealing with Parkinson's for a year.
Uh-huh.
So, I know you, but
Walgreens. Walgreens. I was your man. I was your man. Paul.
I know. But I didn't
familiar
know.
Face.
I didn't know you.
That's
your last name.
How do I know you?
Your last name.
All right. It's good to see you. Thanks for coming.
Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming.
I've never spoken in front of people before, so.
You did a good job.
You did great.
No, that's, and thank you for coming. We need all the.
Much rather have people smoking vapors than the cigarettes that I grew up smoking.
Mm-hmm.
Like my oldest son, he's 23. He just moved in with us like 6 months ago when he couldn't take the 3 flights of stairs. And I was picking on him. And then he said he didn't lose weight to join the service. And he started smoking a vapor cigarettes, and it actually helped him breathe and get into shape. And I've had that happen with a few people, so.
Thank you.
Sure.
I was looking at you, and it was tragic.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And there, I know this.
Everybody knows each other.
It's been, I had had a stroke when before you left.
No.
And then I got hit with Parkinson's, so I have short-term memory. So
okay.
It's not you, John. It's
no.
Me. So
no, because well, we've been out of there for now almost 3 years.
Wow.
So
ooh,
yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, time flies.
Move on. Yes. We're still in an open meeting. You're welcome. You're welcome to hear our deliberations.
It's okay.
No, but you ever see someone that you know?
No, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
That's what when I saw you, I knew who you were when I saw you. You gave me a few shots, I think.
All right.
Agenda.
Yes, the agenda. Well, actually, there's not much left on the agenda, but if you would like to discuss, I'm thinking of tabling our discussion on this, just so we can absorb, answer maybe some of the questions that he had, and absorb what everyone has to say.
Mm-hmm.
If that.
So you'd like to postpone the vote until next month?
Table discussion until next, if there's a motion for that.
I don't think we need to motion.
Well,
if we don't take if we don't vote on it, we don't need to make a motion. We can just make a motion to vote, I think.
Yeah. Next meeting.
And.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, I'm not ready to vote on it myself.
Okay. Then we'll wait.
And so we can table, or you don't
mm-hmm.
Motion to table discussion until our next meeting? Or
sure, we have to motion that? Yeah.
just for the formality of it, I would.
We'll motion to table the vote.
Maybe amend a motion to table and did you, to table a discussion?
Yes.
And the vote?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Okay. I'll second.
Second.
Sorry.
Motion to table discussion until our next meeting.
And vote.
Aye. Three.
Aye.
All in favor?
Aye.
Zero opposed. Darlene, we're going to table discussion until next meeting. Which does anybody have their calendars handy?
Wednesday, which is the 15th.
Is there any chance we could move it up to an earlier Wednesday? I might be gone that third Wednesday. I'm not sure.
I'm
going to
be away one of those weeks.
You're
going to
be away.
That's fine. We're deliberating of next meeting. That's fine.
It's either the 1st or the 8th are the two Wednesdays before the 15th.
The first or the eighth. Of March, right? Either one of those is fine with me. If it's, that's about a month from now.
Maybe we should do this online.
You wanna wait till you have access to a calendar?
I do, because I'm away one of those weeks. And
that's
I don't know
fine.
Wait a minute, I think it's in here.
Okay, we don't have to set a date.
I'm away the week of the 13th, so above that.
So
we'll
be to the 1st and the 8th?
The 1st
yeah.
is Ash Wednesday, if anybody cares.
So maybe the 8th would be okay with
yeah.
people?
March 8th? March 8th seems fine with me.
Okay.
Okay, March 8th.
March 8th.
Darlene, March 8th, we've got for our next meeting.
Can we talk about the health agent or?
Well,
March 8th,
March 8th, Burger Room.
Can we talk about the health agent or not?
Yeah.
Yes. Is Jean, health agent, everything's posted. Do we have any update on our health agent?
Posting for the job?
The posting, yeah, the posting's been advertised, you might have seen it on some of the relevant websites that we talked about.
Mm-hmm.
And we've received several applications.
Okay.
Oh, good.
Oh, good.
In the meantime, the interim health agent has been excellent.
Okay.
And really above and beyond anything that I could have imagined. With the 10 to 15 hours a week that he's providing, he's giving it the all, so.
Great.
I think we're in very good hands with him.
No pressing issues for the board from Bob?
No. The one thing that he brought me up to speed on was the issue that was before the board about restaurant Pavarotti and the external event.
Oh, right, yes.
And the interim health agent went down and had a very nice conversation with him, and he's working very closely with him to come up with a plan and resolve that.
No, he has not come up with a plan yet?
They have been in communication, so I don't know if there's an actual concrete plan. I think that was something that the previous health agent had been given a deadline of January.
January 9th was the...
Yeah, and I think you brought it up at the last meeting, it was in the minutes.
Yeah, no, I thought that was back in July that we... We met and gave him a date to submit plans and or permits, and then a date to complete the
He's in violation of that.
Yeah, I'm not sure of the details of all the dates. Mm-hmm. All I can tell you is that it has been followed up on by the interim health agent.
But the interim health agent hasn't informed me that he's in violation of the
I'm not sure. I haven't been that close to it.
So our way of contacting him though is contacting you.
You'd like, right, you know, this is something you want me to get some more information on, I'd be happy to do that. And I'll work with the chair, and we'll stay within the four corners of the open meeting law to get you those answers. I just don't have them tonight.
I thought we made it fairly clear to the owner what the parameters were.
I think it was clear, yeah. I'm just not sure. Steve DeLauro may have made some progress on that, but I'd want to double check before I responded.
All right, thank you.
Okay?
Thank you.
All right, thanks.
I believe that he has a plan, and I think he's going to bring it in this week.
Oh, okay.
This week. So he has a deadline, and he is supposed to come up and submit some paperwork.
Okay, good. So should we put that on the agenda for the next meeting?
Yeah.
In terms of having him come, or?
Well, at least what the plans are and what
the... I guess if there's no plan, have him come, you think?
Yeah.
Unless he's corrected it by then.
Well, I can let you know when he does come up and submit. It's supposed to be this week.
Okay, we'll keep up on it, yeah.
Thanks.
And as far as the next meeting, can we discuss the pesticide?
Yes.
Pesticide regulations on our next agenda.
Everyone got a copy through Steve?
No.
I didn't see anything.
So you did,
I got one.
But he didn't send it to anyone else in the board.
Oh, okay.
No.
So that means you're going to get a really long email from me to send to everybody else.
Oh, it's in the text of an email.
It is?
I don't know how to do that.
That's great. Oh, thank you so much. All right.
You're worse than me, and I'm pretty bad.
Speaking of which, I went through all our email trails about the healthy weight article.
Yeah, yeah.
And I didn't have a document that I could send.
I have no document on that.
You do?
No, I never saw it.
No, so if you could get me a...
Yeah.
Because I know we sent it, and then I guess it was approved.
Yeah.
But I don't have... And then when we switched over,
yep.
I don't think I got a...
Okay.
Because I've got all the contacts.
Let me just make sure that you all went through it.
Yes. Oh, yes.
I did.
Oh, that's...
Because we have, I thought we even approved it.
We'll have to look at it.
I wasn't at that, I missed that meeting, I think I missed one meeting.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, because that was approved already.
Well, it was approved by the board and approved by the town.
I'm not worried.
Okay, so I got to get that to you.
That would be great.
Because we also voted and approved yours.
We approved it.
We're waiting to hear.
Jean, I submitted the opiate article. Did that make it through town hall yet, or to the ombudsman?
Everything's been forward along, so I assume so.
John, did you get a copy of that?
I did not. Did you send it to me?
Yeah, I sent you a CC'd you at the Verizon.
I've been 10 days on the road, mostly out of internet connection, so.
Okay, I know I.
I've got about a million emails to go through, is it possible to say?
Okay.
I do have a liaison question for you.
Sure.
I've got to run to the next one.
Mm-hmm.
So will you be deliberating this evening, or are you going to?
No, we've tabled.
Your deliberation on the issues are going to be on March 8th?
We've tabled it to the next meeting.
Okay, I just want to be sure I had that date.
Yes.
I wanted to be impressed.
Because we're going to move it up by a week. We usually do the third, this will be in the second of second.
Okay, got it.
And that was fine with you, Andy, on the 8th?
Yes.
Okay, yes, the 8th.
Okay.
So the pesticide article, get that out.
The pesticide regs.
Huh?
The pesticide regs we'll get from Jean.
It's the draft.
Draft, right.
And so I will send that to Jean. Jean will, because when I asked Steve to do it, looks like John was the only one who actually got a copy.
Okay.
But you might want to check your emails. It would be Steve's last week.
You suggesting that we might have missed an email?
Could have.
Virtually possible.
Yeah. I'll check, but.
Check, I'll check. Okay, but I will.
But a long email like that, I would have remembered, I think, but, okay.
Okay, because it's a copy of my draft, it's a copy of pretty much the whole Marbury draft, and then comments from two citizens, and also from the tree warden, I think. Only because we eliminated portions of the Marbury regulations and don't really apply tough testing problems, things like that.
Right. I remember talking about that, but what date did you send them out?
I asked Steve his last week to send it, so that would have been.
I think it was the day that he left is when I remember getting.
Getting it, so that would have been.
It was Thursday. It was right after our last 26th.
Twenty-six?
Twenty-sixth.
Twenty-sixth, it was better than the 26th.
February 26th. No, January.
January.
I got.
Okay, and if not, I'm just going to send it to you anyway tomorrow. Just be safe, yeah.
Oh, wait. Message for Chair. No.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, Jean can send that.
Yeah, I'll take care of that and send it to you. Okay.
Any other topics of discussion for this evening at all?
Nope.
So we got the pesticide regs coming up. I'll get the healthy weight article to you.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll discuss and vote on the tobacco regulations maybe. We'll discuss and maybe vote on them next month.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's all I got.
Okay.
And tough varieties, we'll see.
Well, do we want to get from, I guess, who would we ask for? John has a very specific question about wanting a list of the violations.
Violations.
We get that from
and the
is that?
The re- in actual violations, I guess, would be the.
Maureen.
We can get from
she's
Maureen.
She's not a yes.
Maureen will have all that. Yep.
And
okay.
You, maybe just for Reading, one of the questions was just about Reading.
And I think
and
that was already answered, that Maureen said it was not included in Reading's youth.
Right.
So we know that Reading has not.
Okay, that's not part of the Reading youth risk behavior.
Right.
Okay,
That was part of her,
her presentation.
She said it was Wakefield, and that was the closest
Reading.
We
that's
had.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
But Maureen would have a list of all the retails violations.
Yeah. Okay.
So
okay.
We would need that at our next meeting. Because I think she's
right.
Maureen's
actually
still here.
Is that something we could get from you?
I can supply those before your next meeting.
Good.
That
I didn't
be
see
great.
You because you were
blocked.
Yeah, oh,
so
okay. If we could just get a list of the Reading violations, that would be great.
So I'll supply you with summary.
She's welcome.
Say the last 3 years.
Perfect.
That work.
Perfect. Okay, thank you.
I know I have another question. It'll come to me. Give me a second.
Okay.
So they have some applicants for the health agent position. Do you know when they might be interviewing? Did we ask that? I'm sorry.
Can Darlene hear you? I don't know if she can.
Darlene.
There we are.
Darlene can answer all the questions, really.
Did somebody answer the question about when we might be interviewing for a health agent?
I have not heard they're having interviews. I guess they've got their applications. Maybe I'll even check in with Bob and see if.
Maybe ask Jean right now.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, the sooner the better.
Yeah, we can ask Jean when they're being scheduled.
Jean? Sorry.
Jean, you said you had applications for the health agent position. Have you scheduled any interviews at all, or is that still in the process?
Yeah. Is HR handles the interviewing? How does that? Are they just doing the clearing of the applicants?
Yeah, it's the town manager is the hiring authority.
Okay.
So it would be up to the town manager to schedule the interviews in collaboration with HR. And I think when we talked about this last time, the path that we were talking about is have the chair work with the town manager.
Okay, so I should just deal with Bob and communicate with Bob directly?
Yeah, he's the hiring authority.
Okay.
Yeah, a part-time health agent isn't a good position to be in. He was full-time. Yeah. So you want to get back up to full-time as soon as possible.
Because they have, that's what it's budgeted for.
Full-time.
Yeah, yes, it is. And there are things he do. I think he prepared the way.
Yes.
So then the transition, they gave us some buffer, but we don't want to wait too long.
Right.
I don't, in my opinion, in filling the position.
Sure. And I'll check with Bob to make sure that's high on his list, and maybe if we're privy to who he's got for applicants.
We should be actually sitting in, or one of us should be sitting in on all of these.
On the interviews.
We all did last time. There was at least one of us.
When HR whittles it down to whatever they feel the candidates would be.
Then they just look at, time frames.
Yeah.
Right.
And who was available when, I think.
Yeah, we were in on the primary.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes,
okay.
It wasn't a second.
I did the secondary.
You were part of the second.
Yeah.
Yeah, for the finalists.
The secondary. But one of us was always
right. Yes,
there.
Even by phone. We remember you did a phone.
And I did it by phone,
right. So
which
that's
is difficult.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, I'll talk to Bob. I'll get him on his ear and see if there's a schedule of when he's planning on doing that. What.
Okay. Yeah.
Just conservative, protective. Of us.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yes. Because we have to work with these people.
Right. And we need coverage.
Yeah.
Should something go south.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Anything else? Or
you have to be able to hear everything? I'm sorry.
I know.
I'm like turning my back.
Can I get a copy of
I'm used to being.
Did you get all the minutes there, Darlene?
This one,
I get everything word for word.
Yeah. Oh, God. All right. Good meeting, John. Thanks.
Yeah, good
thanks
job.
Thanks, guys. All right.
So, motion to adjourn?
I'm good. I'll make a motion to adjourn.
I will second that
second?
Motion.
Motion to adjourn tonight's meeting. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? No. Meeting is adjourned.